Good morning. At Carol's grave on Friday, I spoke ancient words from Ecclesiastes, from our Bible, assuring us that there is a time, a season for everything, to cry and to dance, to be born and to die. But I have to tell you that I actually have found words that are perhaps wiser, that better express our sentiments, our deep sorrow this morning. A woman does not have time in her life to have time for everything. She doesn't have seasons enough to have a season for every purpose. Ecclesiastes was wrong about that. A woman needs to love and to hate at the same moment, to laugh and cry with the same eyes, with the same hands to gather stones and throw them, to make love in war and war in love, and to hate and forgive and remember and forget, to arrange and confuse, to eat and to digest what history takes years and years to do. And her soul is seasoned. Her soul is very professional. Only her body remains forever an amateur. It tries and it misses, gets muddled, doesn't learn a thing, fuddled in its pleasures and its pains. She will die, as we all must die, in autumn. Sweet, the leaves of the figs growing dry on the ground, the bare branches pointing to the only place where there's time for everything. From the words of poet Yehuda Amichai. And so we gather this morning again to express our sadness that Carol Goldstein did not have more time. Although she filled her years with such brilliance, so much caring, giving so much to profession and community, and especially to her loving family. To Hank and Jen, Deborah, Brenda, and Bill, Lauren of blessed memory, to grandchildren Oliver and Alex, Haley and Madison, sister Susan and brother David, may he rest in peace. How we wish that Carol and we were given more time. My name is Rabbi Sarah Gilbert, and it's truly my sincere honor to facilitate our memorial today. I thank you so much for coming on, for tuning in from all over the country. It's so unfortunate that we can't gather in person to reach out and touch and hug, but the wonders of technology actually enable more of us to be present for Carol's family, and that is good. We begin with the words of an ancient prayer, expressing our hope for Carol's soul and trust in the Holy One with whom she dwells in the heights now. El Malei Rachamim Shochein Bamaromim Hamsei Menucha Nechona Tachat Kanfei HaShechina B'ma'alot Kedoshim U'Torim K'zoha HaRakia Mazhirim Et Nishmat Carol Bat Daniel Valea Shelhachala Olama Began Eden Tehemenuchata Ana Baal Harachamim Hastireha Beseter Kenafecha La Olamim Utzror Bitzror Hachaim Et Nishmata Adonai hu nachalata v'tanuach b'shalom amishkava v'nomar amen. God filled with mercy dwelling in the heaven's heights, bring proper rest beneath the wings of your presence, amid the company of the holy and the pure, illumining like the brilliance of the skies, to Carol Bat Danielle Valea, Carol Goldstein, daughter of Daniel and Lillian, who has gone to her eternal place of rest. May you, who are the source of mercy, shelter her beneath your wings eternally, and bind her soul among the living, that she may rest in peace. And let us all say, Amen. Sharing tender words is one of the most beautiful ways that we can bring honor to a loved one. It is so good that this morning we will hear from members of Carol's family and friends who are missing her so much. Carol and Hank have four grandchildren, all on whom Carol doted, all of whom Carol would say she loved so much and equally. But I learned that she would say to her first, her oldest grandchild, "You, Oliver, I have loved the longest." Oliver Jones.
Well, hello, everyone. I think everyone knows me. I'm Oliver. I was Carol's oldest grandson. I had the distinct pleasure of being able to spend a lot of time with Grandma Carol in her passing days. She requested that I make a movie about her life. I think she overestimated how much I know about technology, because I've never made a movie before, but I mean, how can you not oblige to a request like that? So I spent a lot of time with her interviewing her about her life. And I think a thing that we all know is just how many special qualities Grandma Carol had. And I also think every single one of us here has a quality of which we identify with the most and of which we respect the most from Grandma. And for me, that was her sense of self. I've never really met anyone who fits the kind of actualization that Grandma has really realized. She was able to have a set list of rights and wrongs that no matter the circumstance, she was able to reflect on to make her decisions. And a lot of that came from her ability to be comfortable with who she was. She knew she was a small Jewish Democrat from New York who loved her caviar and her family more than almost anything else in the world. So I think today, in honor of Grandma, I want to say something to everyone present here today that I think she would have wanted me to say. And that's for everyone to be comfortable with who they are. Because that's what Grandma Carol really meant to me, was she was able to be her own person despite circumstance, social pressure, national pressure. It didn't matter. Grandma Carol knew who she was. And that's something that every one of us here should be able to identify with. We should know who we are and stick to our morals and try to be more like Grandma Carol in that way. So to the woman, you know, who has pushed me to get a bar mitzvah, took me to New York, and loved this family so much, I say goodbye.
Susie Hyman, Carol's beloved sister, is with us virtually from Rochester, New York this morning.
A sibling grieves not only for the present, but for the loss of a shared past. I am so very sad that our younger brother David now only lives in our hearts and is part of the shared past I had with Carol. I remember when Carol was my big, big sister. She was 11 years older and I thought she was oh so glamorous. She danced on a stage and wore nylons and had 45 RPM records. I remember when Grandma Hyman put chicken feet in the tzimmis just for Carol. I remember how proud our dad was when Carol helped Grandpa at 96 navigate the cardiac care decisions he had to make. Carol introduced me to so many things. When I was 14, she made me promise to taste what she ordered, and who knew that people actually ate snails? Then she became a mother and moved out to Denver, and our relationship matured over time. She was no longer my big, big sister, but she still introduced me to magical things like Hong Kong and Chinese furniture and anti-nausea wristbands. Carol remained a hymen. She was persistent, socially conscious, and forthright. You always knew what she thought. For her diminutive stature, she was larger than life. I read a questionnaire recently that asked if the reader was A, a cat person, B, a dog person, C, a people person. Carol would have checked all of the above and added D, a family person. Family was important to her. She was there for the weddings, the bar mitzvahs, the graduations, whether in Rochester in the winter, which she hated, or Houston in the humidity, which she hated. She gave of herself to all of us. And in return, we gave her our hearts as one of the most valued of her valuable collections. I remember how good the good times have been and how her cancer has made every day and every smile more special. In recent conversation with Hank, the Ryan O'Neill of her love story, I reflected that Carol had more lives than a cat. She was a dancer and nurse, an anti-smoking advocate, a researcher, a teacher, a political operative, an antique dealer, a decorator, an ovarian cancer awareness educator, a devoted wife, mother, grandmother, cousin, sibling, and friend. In the 8 years since her diagnosis, she's accomplished more and touched more lives than most people do in a lifetime. I remember not only how Carol enriched my life for the past 2/3 of a century, what she taught me as she faced death with self-awareness and grace. Our shared memories wrote the script for the relationship that grew and matured as we did. And this love will patina with memory and will be with me every day. When my memory fades, it will remain an essence of sisterly love. And reflecting on my sister's life, no words are more appropriate than Frank Sinatra's. I've lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway and more. Much more than this, I did it my way. My sister, Caroline Hyman Goldstein, most certainly did it her way. May her memory be for a blessing.
Allison Fricke is Carol's niece.
So I am Carol's niece, Allison, Susan's daughter. So I went to the Abstract Expressionist exhibition at the Met yesterday in honor of my Aunt Carol. There was Pollock and Frankenthaler and de Kooning and Clifford Still, and of course Rothko, because Aunt Carol loved Rothko. Even though my Aunt Carol lived halfway around the world and halfway across the country most of my life, we developed a close bond from our shared love of art and dance. There's a story of me visiting at maybe 11 or 12 years old. I saw a painting in Hank's office of a young girl with my eyes, same narrow chin, same slight frame, and dancer posture. Startled, I asked her, "Why do you have a painting of me?" She laughed and told me it was her. I realized in that moment that I saw myself in her. In the years to come, she became a guiding figure in my life. At the funeral, Rabbi Gilbert spoke about how close Carol was to her Aunt Gertrude. Carol was my Aunt Gertrude. In a word, she was fabulous. She loved New York. When she visited, we would get together with the New York family, and she would commandeer whoever was sitting next to me and make them switch so she could really find out what was going on in my life and advise me. I have a lot of great memories from those visits. One spring, somehow it was just the two of us for an afternoon, so we went to MoMA. Walking along 54th Street, she told me about growing up in New York and the time she spent in class near MoMA. When I say she was fabulous, who else but a fabulous person goes to school across the street from MoMA? She lived an inspirational life, curated to meaningfully reflect her identity and values. Essentially, she lived her life the way she wanted to live it. And she wanted everybody else to live their lives the way she wanted to live them too. And sooner or later, you realize that she was always right. I felt standing in front of the Rothko paintings yesterday that her energy and vitality was as all-encompassing and gravitational as a 10-foot Rothko painting. Much like Rothko, Carol's legacy is robust and unforgettable. It is in us, her family and friends, who are indelibly inked with her influence in special, profound ways. She is the voice in the back of my mind saying, buy the best and you'll only cry once. It's kind of a funny concept and good style advice, but what it really means is she wants the best for the people she loves. And she wanted me to pursue what I want with the same vigor that she pursued what she wanted. It's a gift to have someone like that in your life. And I know I'm better because of her. I miss her very much.
Danny Hyman is Carol's nephew, and he brings his reflections and his memories.
Hi, everybody. I'm Danny Hyman. I'm Carol's nephew. Thank you for letting me speak. Carol was an incredible human being who touched countless people. I became very close with Carol over the last few years, and I had the good fortune of being able to visit Carol and Hank countless times over the last decade. I think I'm not unique in this, but Carol fulfilled a Jewish motherly role for me. She welcomed me into her exquisitely decorated basement, which served as a home away from home. She also insisted that Denver would make a great first home and encouraged me to move there often. It's a shame that I hadn't, the winds have not blown me there yet permanently. She always made sure I was eating well. She prepared delicious meals. Her clay pot chicken was a fan favorite. Whenever we went to a restaurant, no matter what restaurant, no matter what city, she somehow was friends with the owner, the waiter, the chef, the hostess, just about everybody in the joint. And you always were well taken care of. She was elated when I met a nice Jewish girl, Alexa, and she was one of the first members of our family to meet her. She welcomed Alexa unequivocally, and I'm glad she got to see her engagement. Carol thrived throughout her journey with ovarian cancer, and she remained a force to be reckoned with. Medically, although I knew that today was an inevitability, Carol lived with such unstoppable strength and grace that she would leave this physical world always felt to me to be a distant abstraction. Despite her passing, her compassion, her strength and grace lives on in the countless people around the world she cared about. Carol, we love you and we miss you.
Alyssa Hyman is Carol's cousin.
I'm Carol's cousin, Alyssa, an attorney from New York City. Like so many of you, Carol is and will remain a key person in my life. My father and Carol's father were brothers and very much alike. While Carol and I did not get to see each other often when I was a child, when we were older, we developed an emotional bond built in large part over our similar paternal experiences. Carol and I also share a sizable dose of some of the Hyman family's main traits. The polite word for those traits are tenacity and directness. No matter what Carol was going through over the past 8 years, she was always a diligent older cousin, checking in on how I was, telling me she loved me, telling me she missed me, and dispensing advice on my life. In these days of careless text messaging, she never forgot to mail a birthday card. To me, Carol was a superhero who had 48 hours in every day and just accomplished more than anybody else I know. As an attorney, I don't normally feel nervous about speaking in public, but I felt as anxious about speaking today and how my hair looked as if Carol were watching me. This is a testament to Carol's power. I was struggling about what to write, so I just decided to read something brief that I wrote to Carol in her book, months late, as I don't think I really could face what was happening. This was on August 4th, 2020 at 1:47 a.m. I've already shared with you what I want to say, but I'll say something for the book. I deeply admire you and think of you and your life as life goals. You're a shining example of what the stubborn, tenacious, never take no for an answer Hyman traits can do when packaged in such a beautiful, brilliant, talented woman who has amazing taste and unprecedented organizational skills. While I've often pushed back against your advice and we have chosen different life paths, you are frequently in my head dispensing affirmative advice or simply reaction. I regularly think to myself, what would Carol do or what would Carol say or advise in response to something I have done or more often what I have not done? I hear you say, sweetheart, woulda, coulda, shoulda. and I know that you're right. Had I followed your advice, there's no doubt I would have been much thinner, had a much better wardrobe, a well-furnished and fabulous apartment, and smaller eye bags, just to name a few of the things I know you've been right about. I'm admitting it, you are right. At the same time, as you know, I don't always agree with you, and we have enjoyed our share of healthy dialogues about life choices. I'll continue to dialogue with you long after this letter is written, and I'm certain you will be there holding up your end of the discussion. You are always in my heart, you've always been in my heart, and you'll always be in my heart. I love you very much, and I'll never stop.
Lee Asinapura is Carol's dear friend of over 50 years, whom Carol met when both were young ICU nurses in New York City.
Carol was my best friend of 53 years. You don't lose somebody like her without feeling a deep pain and a sense of loss. I asked her what made her go through this endurance. And she said, what choice do I have? And I said, you have a choice. You have a choice to give up, but giving up was not Carol's way. And she endured it all after 8 long years of ovarian cancer. She endured it all. She was my best friend, and I don't think it's an exaggeration to say she was my heart and my soul. I am honored to call her my best friend.
We thank you, O God of life and love, for our gift of memory, which endows your children fashioned in your image with the God-like sovereign power to give immortality through love. Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, who enables your children to remember. Carol's family has composed a photo montage. With love and tears, we can sit back now and remember.
Secret of life is enjoying the passage of time. Any fool can do it. There ain't nothing to it. Nobody knows how we got to the top of the hill. Since we're on our way down, we might as well enjoy the ride. The secret of love is in opening up your heart. It's okay to feel afraid, but don't let that stand in your way. 'Cause anyone knows that love is the only road. And since we're only here for a while, might as well show some style. Give us a smile. Isn't it a lovely ride? Slide. Try too hard, it's just a lovely ride.
Ner Adonai Nishmat Adam. Baruch atah Adonai Notea Bitochenu Chaye Olam. The human spirit is the lamp of God. Blessed is the Eternal One who has implanted within us eternal life. Thank you so much. You know how Carol cherished your friendship. I am so appreciative that Carol's nephew, Bubba Fricky, and dear friend, Alyssa Miller, will bring their song for us this morning, a lovely tribute to Carol.
When you're down and troubled, and you need a helping hand, and nothing, oh, nothing is gold. Your eyes and think of me, and soon I will be there to brighten up even the darkest night. You just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come. Spring, summer, or fall, all you've got to do is call home, and I'll be there.
Is a finite flame. It burns, it glows, it grows, but in time, as all things finite, it ends. The flame diminishes in size, it becomes dimmer, and in its time, it will be extinguished. So are human lives. We are born, we grow, we find success, and make a name for ourselves in some way, through our actions or through our family or through those whom we know and influence, we can touch a part of eternity. Yet life itself is finite, and so we grieve. There will be a time for celebration, for more music and for dance, song and laughter and drink. We will come together to enjoy the future. You will share more beautiful memories of Carol, her brilliance and grace, her awesome contribution to your community and beyond, her deep love for each of you, and that will be with you forever. But meantime, may the Holy One bless each of you with comfort and strength and the beautiful memories that will sustain each of us now. And together we say one more time, Amen. Thank you all here together, all together virtually, for being together to honor and express your love for Carol Goldstein. Blessings to you for this day and this season.